Good morning. Great to see you here at Memorial Heights Baptist Church. If you're just visiting with us today, you're just joining us online, I'm Pastor DJ. So glad to have you as part of our service. Why don't you stand up as we worship the Lord together in song? Standing on the promises of Christ, my King. Eternal ages, let his praises ring. Glory in the highest, I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing. Stay standing for this next song. It's based on Psalm 23. Some great promises.
Oh Lord, you're my shepherd. You make me lie in fields of green. You lead me by the still waters. You restore righteousness to me. Though I walk through the valley, I will fear no evil thing, for you are with me, and you comfort me. Surely goodness, love, and mercy will follow. I will fear no evil. will follow wherever I go. Surely goodness, love, and mercy will follow wherever I go. Surely goodness, love, and mercy will follow wherever I go. Wherever I go, wherever I go, I know your mercy will follow.
It's an amazing promise. Let's sing it together.
I'm gonna dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I'm gonna dwell.
Amen. Whether we're at the table of blessing or in the valley of the shadow, He is with us. His goodness and mercy follow us. You may be seated. This has been an unprecedented year, not only in the life of our church, but in churches all around the world, as we've dealt with the virus and the restrictions and all that has come with that. And so we are excited about things ramping back up here in our church with Awana will be starting up soon, and we're going to be making some changes. Pastor Nick's going to talk about a few of those here in just a moment. But one of the things that we are behind on and that we've been late to address, that I have wanted to address, that we as leadership have talked about since I came on as your senior pastor, is adding to our deacons. And we have a great need for more deacons. And we want to be wise about how we approach this because, like I said, things have been delayed in addressing this issue and coming together on this. But we have been praying over the last year and a half. And as we've been praying and meeting, right now we have three active deacons. And we have prayed and considered bringing on a fourth. And so on August 25th, which is 10 days from now, we're going to be voting as a church on bringing Elmer Windsor on as a deacon. Elmer is a faithful man of God. He meets all the qualifications that are given to us in 1 Timothy 3. His wife Peggy meets all the qualifications of a deacon's wife that are given to us in 1 Timothy chapter 3. And so we're excited that Elmer has met with us and has agreed, as he and Peggy have prayed about this. And so we're going to ask you over the next 10 days to pray about that as well. We are a congregational church, and so this will be a congregational decision. But we will have a special business meeting after prayer meeting on the 25th to present and vote on Elmer Windsor as a deacon. So please be praying about that. Another change that is going to be coming up here in our church, we have decided that on months that have five Sundays, on the fifth Sunday of those months, we're going to have a family Sunday. And what that means this month, because we're just starting out, is that we are not going to have a Sunday morning Bible study on that day, August 29th. We're just going to have the one morning service. And we're not going to have any children's church over there. We're just going to have just for the, we'll still have a nursery for the babies. We're going to try to scale things back. We're going to have one service for all the family. We're going to be in here worshiping together. We'll be doing the service just a little bit different because we understand we'll have kids, so we'll be incorporating them a little bit into what we're doing up here as well. And so we're excited about that. As we get farther into this, we'll be doing some different things on the evening service as well. This month, we're going to be focusing, starting out this new thing, focusing on Sunday morning specifically. So we have some other changes that Pastor Nick's going to come tell you about, and I'll turn it over to him.
All right. Along with all the changes, we've got more. Dada, I love that. So we will be having a senior dinner at 5 p.m. on the 17th. Sign up is in the foyer hallway. Bring a dessert. They have enough of everything else. So Boston cream pie is my favorite. And if I can make it, that would be appreciated. This Thursday, the 19th, there's going to be an outreach dinner at the Mission at 4:30. If you're interested in helping out with that, talk to Jana Hook, or I'm sure Paul also has information on that as well. Baptismal service on the 22nd. If you're interested, talk to one of us today, one of the pastors, one of the deacons, and next week we will be having that service during the Sunday morning service. Also on the 22nd after the service, this is concerning anybody involved in the Sunday morning Bible study, children's ministry, or if you are involved in children's church, we're going to be having a meeting after service. We're going to have a little lunch provided for everyone. And so if you're there with your families, love that. Just going to keep rolling on. So come out. Just threw me off a little bit. Come out. We have lunch. We're going to go through everything that's going to be changing in those ministries, which I'm going to be talking about now. We are starting a new security system, along with thinking that Elmer would be a great deacon. We also think that he'd be a great security system, so we're hiring him for that. Just kidding. We are starting a new security system. Most of you that have children have already signed up for that. But if you have not, we need to be able to build a profile for you and your child. There's papers over there that you can fill out, so that you don't have to worry about doing it online, and I'll enter it in so that everything's done the way that it needs to be. But it's going to be starting up. It's for us to be able to protect our kids. There'll be a pickup spot, a drop-off spot for your child, and safe people that you have designated as pickup. It's a really great system. It's easy to use. It's going to take a little bit to get adjusted to because it is different than what we do now. But it is going to overall hopefully help things run smoother, more safe for our kids, more safe for our volunteers. And so this is something that we really wanted to do for the purpose of, well, we have a lot more young families coming. And so we want to make everybody feel safe, comfortable. And one way of doing that is to implement this new system. That's starting September 5th. We are also starting a new college and career class on September 5th. So if you're interested in that, Butch Jenkins is going to be teaching that. So we're super excited to be able to offer that. So if you're in college or you're freshly out of college, around in that age, or if you're not in college, but you're in the workforce and you're around that age, we would love to have you in that class. Also, Children's Church, it's going to be a little bit different starting next month. We will be having children from ages 5 to 8. Right now, it's 5 to 9. I don't think we have any 9-year-olds in there, so it's not going to change a whole lot. However, so that we can have the curriculum from ages 5 all the way through ages 18, we're going to be using the Gospel Project. Part of that is changing those things up so that we can better serve those kids and families. So we'll be going through the entire Bible every 3 years. And so from ages 5 to 18, if you go through that all the way, you should have gone through the Bible about 4 times in totality over the course of that time, which is awesome. But it does change up the class sizes a little bit. Also in the hallway, sign up sheet for the church picnic, which is going to be on September 26th, 4 o'clock to 7 o'clock p.m. here at the church. when you sign up, make sure you put how many people are coming with your family and what you will be bringing. Again, Boston cream pie. It's a great dessert. My favorites. And if there's multiple there, that means maybe somebody will get to leave one in the fridge for me during the week. And that would be awesome. I don't need it, but I definitely want Boston cream pie. So that is all my announcements for today. And I'm going to turn it over to Scott for the prayer requests and prayer for opening the service. Nope, just kidding.
I just had one more thing.
Okay.
Do you have anything else?
I think that's all.
Okay, great. We are going to have prayer requests here in a moment, but we do have a praise this morning. There was almost a tragedy at the pool just a few days ago, but Lacey Foster and one of her friends saved a child from drowning. And so we're very thankful that she and her friend, God, had them there for that. And we certainly want to praise the Lord for that.
All right, we do have a number of prayer requests and many that aren't listed also, but we need to continue to pray for Jim Zoller. Also, Bob McCullough, his bladder surgery was postponed, but he's still in the hospital. Peggy Williams, Carolyn and Dawn Balger. Tamara Elaine Hamalo has some tests in Pittsburgh, so pray for her. Crystal Mallory, Sherry Stump, Rick Wolford, Dennis Metz, Phil Duncan, a friend of Pastor DJ's, is hospitalized with COVID. Many others, friends and family also are dealing with COVID right now. We have many sick among us and those who have lost loved ones recently, and continue to pray for our nation. So if you go ahead and let's bow and pray to the Lord. Father, we do thank you, Lord, for the many blessings you've bestowed upon us. Father, we thank you that we're able to be in your house this morning. Father, we know that around us there's many sick, many going through tests, dealing with cancer, COVID, and other physical needs. And Father, you are the great physician. Lord, our prayer is, Lord, that you would desire that they would all be healed. And Lord, that you would get the praise from that. Father, there's also many unspoken requests, those that are dealing with emotional and spiritual issues. And Father, we do pray today, if there's any here among us watching online or elsewhere that does not know you as Lord and Savior, Lord, we pray that today would be that day of salvation. Father, we pray now that you put a hedge of protection around our church, around our pastor, our leaders. Lord, and the Holy Spirit would have full reign in the service today. We love you. We praise you. We ask this all in Christ's name. Amen.
One of the rare occasions when I didn't almost trip. So, interesting song choices thus far this morning. Standing on the promises given to us in the 23rd Psalm. This song mentions the promise of the Holy Spirit. And the second verse speaks of the Lord Jesus himself and his experience with the woman at the well and how she came to him.
There is a river that flows from deep within. There is a fountain that frees the soul from sin. Come to these waters, there is a vast supply. There is a river that never shall run dry. There came a sound from heaven, like a mighty rushing wind. It filled their hearts with singing and gave them peace within. The prophet gave this promise. He said, the Spirit will descend, and from your inner being a river with no end. There is a river that flows from deep within. There is a fountain that frees the soul from sin. Come to these waters, there is a vast supply. There is a river that never shall run dry. There came a thirsty woman. She was drawing from a well. You see, her life was ruined and wasted, and her soul was bound for hell. Oh, but then she met the Master, who told of her great sin. He said, if you'll just drink of this water, you'll never thirst again. There is a river that flows from deep within. There is a fountain that frees the soul from sin. Come to these waters, there is a vast supply. There is a river that never shall run dry. Oh, there is a river that never shall run dry.
Amen. And the Bible that tells us, those of us who have drank from that river, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. And so we're going to say so in this next song. You can remain seated for this next one. This is your testimony. Let's sing it out to the Lord together.
He led me out of the desert. He brought me into this stream, a river of living water. Turned my bitter into sweet, all my burdens are lifted. You took the shackles off my feet. There's no sound louder than a captive set free. So let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Sing of his promises evermore. Pour out your thankfulness. Let it overflow and let the redeemed of the Lord say so. There is joy in the morning, springing up in my soul. There is life worth living, 'cause he calls me his own. And there's a hallelujah after sweet victory. There's no sound louder than a captive set free. No, there's no sound louder than a captive set free. So let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Sing of his promises evermore. Pour out your thankfulness. Let it overflow and let the redeemed of the Lord say so. My deliverer, the freedom I'm living in. You are my deliverer, you are my promised land. You are my deliverer, the freedom I'm living in. You are my deliverer, you are my promised land. So let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Sing of his promises evermore. Pour out your thankfulness. Let it overflow and let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Pour out your thankfulness. Let it overflow and let and I'll never be alone anymore. How could my voice be quieted? You're my deliverer. You're my deliverer.
Because he is who he says he is, I am who he says I am, and he says that I'm his. Let's stand as we sing one more song together. Who am I? Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I at last he has ransomed me, his grace was deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am who you say I am. I'm a child of God, yes I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. Oh, I am who you say I am. Yes, I am who you say I am. Father, I'm so thankful this morning that this world is not my home, that your home is my home, because you have made me a child of God by your grace. Father, you sent your Son Jesus Christ to die for my sin. You raised him from the dead, and now I can be forgiven. I can be alive. I can be a child of God by your grace through faith. Father, we love you. We praise you, God. We ask for your Spirit, God, who you've given to all your children, God, to give us wisdom and insight and understanding into your word today, into who you are, and to who you have made us and called us to be. And we ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Kids, you are dismissed to Children's Church. In a few weeks, we won't be saying that. But while we can, you guys can head to Children's Church. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16. My parents used to take my sister and I up to Altoona almost every week to see my grandparents back when I was growing up here in Cumberland and when my grandparents were still alive. And Marcy and I used to joke because it seemed like every trip we'd drive through town and Mom would say, "I grew up on that corner. There used to be a house there." We'd drive by the old bowling alley. "That's where your mom and I had our first date." Say, "Yeah, we know. We know. We heard about it." I'm going to show you a verse before we jump into Ephesians that I take you to all the time. But I want you to know this verse. I want you to live this verse. I want you to believe and claim this verse. It's Matthew chapter 16, verse 18. "I say unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. And the gates of Hades, of hell, shall not prevail against it." Jesus made a promise that he was going to do something new. Now, we've all heard this new and improved thing, right? New and improved. And as I've shared with you before, most of us would choose old and familiar over new and improved any old day, because we've come to experience new and improved as just a sales pitch often. Now, if it's old and broken, yeah, we want new and improved to replace it. But old and familiar can be so much more comforting than something that, oh, it's new, but it's not necessarily improved. How easily it breaks. How hard it is to learn the new and improved parts. But Jesus said, "I'm going to do something that is new, that is amazingly improved." And when Jesus talks about new and improved, you can bet your eternity on it. Jesus said, "I'm going to build something called the ecclesia, my called out assembly. I'm going to build my called out assembly. And when I build it, the gates of hell will not prevail against it." Now, I've shared with you before in this verse that we know that Jesus was standing at the feet of Mount Hermon when he said this. And at the feet of Mount Hermon, at the cave of Pan, there was a place of pagan worship that was called the gates of hell. And I believe that he was referring to the very rock where he was standing when he said. He's not talking about Peter. He's not saying you are Petros, and on Petra I will build my church. He's saying you are Petros, you're the little rock, Peter, but on this rock right here, this big rock, Mount Hermon, I will build my church. I believe it's where he gave us the Great Commission in Mark 16 and Matthew chapter 28. On that very place, he established his church, something new, something Spirit-empowered that the gates of hell will not be able to overcome and will not prevail against. Now turn with me to Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1. We're going to talk about the church today. We've been talking about spiritual blessings in Ephesians chapter 1. We've been talking about spiritual needs and praying for the needs we still have. We have spiritual blessings in heaven, but we need to experience those spiritual realities on earth, so we have spiritual needs to experience those spiritual blessings. That's the second half of Ephesians chapter 1. And then at the very end of Ephesians chapter 1, in speaking of the greatness of Jesus Christ, verse 19, the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power. I don't know how Paul could emphasize the power of God anymore, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead. I don't know how he could display the power of God any more than in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And he set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, and hath put all things under his feet and given him to be this great God that we serve, all powerful over death and hell and the grave and all the forces of Satan and all of creation combined. He hath given him to us as the head to the church, his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. Now, last week in chapter 2, we talked about grace through faith. We talked about the resurrection power, and we began to talk about spiritual life and how spiritual life begins. We looked at the power of God at work in the believer's life when a sinner admits that they're a sinner, recognizes that they are under condemnation from a holy and righteous God, and that they are without hope, and that they're under condemnation, and they're under damnation, and that they're headed to hell. But God, chapter 2 says, rich in mercy, verse 4, for his great love wherewith he hath loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ, by grace you're saved, and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. Resurrection power has given us new life. Resurrection power has given us freedom. Resurrection power has given us purpose. And today we're going to begin to look at how this resurrection power results in what Paul calls one new man. What he told us about at the end of chapter 1, the body of Christ, risen again in heaven, but here on earth in the church, his called out assembly. And we're going to talk about this one new man. See, we have individual resurrection power that is at work inside of us. We talked about that last week, but I want to talk to you today in chapter 2 about the resurrection realities of what happens when we receive Christ and we become part of the body of Christ. And some incredible resurrection realities that God has given to us for his church. There's 5 of them here in this chapter we're going to cover together. 5 resurrection realities of this one new man. And we're going to pick up this morning where we left off last week. Last week we focused on the individual application of this. Today we're going to talk more about the corporate, the communal, the family reality of this. If you are in Christ Jesus today, you have a new purpose. 5 resurrection realities as the church. Number 1, we have a new purpose. Look again at verse 8, 9, and 10 of Ephesians chapter 2. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Note the change from you to we. Why the change? Because salvation is an individual decision, but it has family, corporate consequences. You make a decision to trust in Jesus Christ, but the moment you do, you enter into a family, and now you have family responsibilities. I made a decision. It was my decision. It wasn't her decision. She's going to tell you it was her decision for me to ask her to marry me. I made the decision to ask Gigi to marry me. And the moment I did, and she said yes, eventually, she said yes. No. She said yes right away. When we became a family, that individual decision had family consequences. Now I have a family that I have a responsibility to, not just myself. Okay? And now God's blessed us with a bundle of pride and joy and energy and attitude and sense of humor and intelligence. You'll see him running around here after the service. Running around is right. I have father responsibilities and husband responsibilities, individual decision, but corporate family consequences, family responsibilities. That's a great thing, but it's a reality we need to live with. Listen, the same thing is true when you become a Christian. You are not saved by your works, but when you are saved, you have responsibilities. You have responsibilities. Now, I want you to look at these verses again. We together are in Christ. We are, chapter 1, verse 22, we are the church. Verse 23, we are the body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. God sent the Holy Spirit to indwell us individually, but God has also sent the Holy Spirit to indwell us corporately. And there's a way that the Holy Spirit works individually that is different than how he works when we are gathered. And that's why you need to be here when we are gathered. Or with the church. Because he doesn't just do it here. He does it everywhere where the church is gathered. The Holy Spirit, where the true church is gathered, where the true Jesus is preached and proclaimed and worshiped. The Holy Spirit is working in a way that is different than when we're at home reading our Bible. He's working in a way and connecting us in a way that's different than when we are at work or at play or on vacation. Where He is working here today in a way that is different. We have a purpose. We'll talk as we get farther into this book together, Lord willing, chapter 4, we'll talk a lot about what it means to be the body of Christ. We'll talk what it means, Lord willing, next week about what it means to be the household and the temple of God. And when we get to chapter 5, we'll talk about what it means to be the bride of Christ. But we have a corporate purpose to be part of something bigger than just our own life and our own testimony, to be part of the church. Now, remember, I got to stop here for a moment. I need to remind you that this purpose comes only by God's grace, and it comes only through saving faith. Faith is not a work. You're not here to work for any kind of status with God. You're not here to work to become a child of God. You're not here to work to try to put in your time and punch in the time clock to try to earn any status before God. You only can become a child of God one way, and that's through faith. It's his grace that makes you a child, but it's received by faith. Faith is not a work. Faith is not a work. It's a conduit. But true saving faith will produce the fruit of works. Now, this cord is a conduit. This mic runs on batteries. I'm not going to mess with that right now, okay? This mic does not do you any good unless it's attached. But the cord is only a conduit. What it needs is power, right? What it needs is power. The cord connected to the mic gives it the power that it needs. It's not the cord that powers the mic. It's just the conduit, but the cord's got to be there. And faith is the same way. It's your faith is not really by itself what saves you, because if your faith is plugged into the wrong thing, you're not going to get power. Think about your home. We've been blessed. One of the things that is truly new and improved in society is running water, right? Indoor plumbing. We don't have to go to the outhouse in the middle of the night. We can go to the room in our house dedicated for that. The pipe is not going to get your clothes clean. The pipe is not going to quench your thirst. But without the pipes connected to the source, you're not getting the water into your house. The pipe is the conduit. The cord is the conduit. What you need when you're thirsty is water. But you better make sure the pipe is connected to the water source, or else you can turn that faucet all day long. Nothing's coming out. Faith is the same way. It's God's grace that saves us. But if your faith is not plugged in to Jesus Christ, if you're trusting in your works, if your faith is in works and not in the grace of Jesus Christ, his death for your sin, his payment, his shed blood to pay for all your sin, his resurrection, literal, physical, to enable you to have resurrection, to enable you to have eternal life. If you're not trusting in him, if your faith isn't plugged in, then that grace is not coming down. It's not going to get to you. Notice in James, when the book of James talks about faith without works, James does not say in James chapter 2 that faith without works is insufficient. He doesn't say faith without works is incomplete. He's not saying that you have to have faith plus works in order to be saved. That's not what he's saying. He says faith without works is dead. It means it's not real faith. It's not living faith. See, when you have living faith, you don't have to add anything to it. But as a sign that it has a pulse, it will produce something. Living things breathe. It will produce something if it is truly saving faith. Jesus said, by your fruits you'll know them. Matthew chapter 7, Matthew chapter 12, you will be able to identify the type of tree that something is by the fruits on it. And you'll be able to tell whether it's a good tree or a bad tree by the fruit that it produces. Now, sometimes you got to wait for the fruit. Sometimes the fruit is growing, but it isn't visible yet. And so we do go through seasons, even as Christians, where that fruit is slow in making itself visible. But understand, if you truly believe in Jesus Christ, there's going to be evidence of that. There's going to be evidence. The evidence is not what saves you. The evidence is what demonstrates that you've been truly saved. Now, let me say one more thing about this before we move on. We've talked at length about election, and we're going to talk about it one more time. Biblical election, chapter 1, always deals with service, never salvation. And this purpose for the church, for service, Paul says here in verse 10, that we are created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. You become a new creation when you are in Christ Jesus. When you place your faith in the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ for the only and all-sufficient payment for your sin, He is your eternal life. You're not working for it. You're not trying to earn it by good works or baptism or giving or just being a good person. You are trusting in Jesus Christ. He is, Jesus said Himself, John 14:6, I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. And ain't nobody getting to my dad apart from me. No man cometh unto the Father except by me. So when you recognize that, you're saved. That's faith, placing your faith and trust. And the moment Paul says you do that, God pours out His grace on you. And He makes you a new creation in Christ Jesus. And you get to be part of this we, this purpose of this church, this ecclesia. Not just here, but all over our community. Not just in our community, but all over the country. Not just our country, but all over the world. The Church of Jesus Christ has a mission and a purpose. And you get to be part of that. But understand the order of this. Election deals with service, never salvation. Some people believe that you are not, they will quote this verse, and they will claim this verse, but they don't really believe this verse. They believe you are not saved by grace through faith. They believe you are saved by faith through grace. They think that grace is the conduit. And that God's looking up in heaven and said, I'm going to choose this microphone to use today. And so I'm going to plug my grace into them, and then I'm going to send them the faith that they need so that they can receive what I've already decided I'm going to give them. And as we get farther into this chapter, we're going to see that everything that Paul says completely destroys that. That is a false gospel. I'm not saying that to offend anybody. I'm saying it because you need to know the truth. You are not saved by faith through grace. You are saved by grace through faith. When you receive God's grace is when you place your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. That's when you receive God's grace. That's when you are made a new creation. That's when you are brought into the church. That's when you have a new purpose for life. So let's make this personal. Every believer has been given and equipped with a spiritual gift to function within this body or whatever body God has placed that believer in. You have a spiritual gift that enables you to be connected to the body. Turn with me. We're gonna spend a lot more time on this when we get to chapter 4, but I want you to see chapter 4 because I want you to know where Paul is going with this when he talks about the fact that now you make a decision, but now we have a role. We are a workmanship, and you're not going to get that purpose. You're not going to fulfill that mission on your own by yourself. Disconnected from the body. Listen to what he says here, that he gave some, chapter 4, verse 11, he gave some apostles and some prophets, they're the foundation of the church, and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Evangelists are what we call missionaries. Pastors and teachers in the Greek is one office with two emphases. For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. So it's my job as a pastor, it's a missionary's job as a missionary to take the apostles and prophets, which is this right here, and to use this to mature you and equip you so that you, with us, can do the work of the ministry till verse 13, we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature, that we henceforth, verse 14, be no more children, tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they laid in wait to deceive, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up into Him in all things, which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which, listen to this, every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working, the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of self in love. See, this requires all of us. This is not just you get the right pastor in place and he'll do everything. No. It's our job, it's the missionary's job, to take the apostles and prophets and to equip us so that we are all equipped, that we do this together and everybody has a part to play. You have a purpose, and it's a family purpose. This is your family. You say, I didn't choose my family. Well, we never choose our family, right? Thank God for my family. Now, I chose that family. That's the only one. Everybody else has been given to me. You don't choose you choose where you worship every week, but you need to choose somewhere. Time to come back. If you're watching online, if you're sitting at home drinking your coffee, some of you have a very legitimate reason. We do this for shut-ins. We do this for those who can't be here, those who are sick, those who are unable to be here, and we understand that. Okay, there is no judgment here. We're not trying to be legalistic on this. But listen, you need to be here. You need to be serving. You need to be fellowshipping. You need the body of Christ, and the body of Christ needs you. And when we're not all together serving together, there's something that is missing. You have a purpose. And it's a new purpose. It's something that you didn't have before. We'll talk more about spiritual gifts in depth when we get to chapter 4. But for now, you have a new purpose. Number two, you have new privileges. You have new privileges as part of this thing called the ecclesia, the called out assembly, the church of Jesus Christ. Look at verse 11. Wherefore, remember. Stop and think about this. Remember that ye, being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands, that at that time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope, and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. You have new, amazing privileges. Let's break this down for a moment. Remember what we used to be. Remember that your sin once separated you from God. Our sin once separated us from God. Now, if you've never placed your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, his death and his resurrection, for the forgiveness of your sins, then you have not received this grace. You do not have this new purpose. You do not have these new privileges yet. You can, and we pray that today will be the day that you become one of the family, that you enter into the family of God, that you receive God's grace by faith. But for those of us who have, remember that your sin once separated you from God. And notice the five things here that you did not have. Number one, you did not have Christ before you got saved. Can I say it one more time? Nobody is born saved. Nobody was placed in Christ for salvation before the foundation of the world. That is not what Paul says in chapter 1. He says, in Christ you are chosen. Not you are chosen to be in Christ. In Christ, yes, now you are chosen. God has, from the beginning, set it up that all who place their faith and trust in Christ are chosen by God, and they have eternal life, and they have a home forever with him. They have an eternal Father. But you were not born that way. You were without Christ. And if you're not saved here today, you don't have a Savior yet. You might be trusting in a politician to save you. You might be trusting in a shot to save you. You may be trusting in something. And listen, We pray for good politicians and we pray for effective medications, but listen, none of that's going to be your savior. None of it. Because even if you live another 50 years, you are going to die if Jesus tarries. And we're all, and I hope most of us live more than another 50 years, but even if you live 100 years, even if you live another 500 years, if they develop some kind of great new technology, you were not born saved. I don't care who you, listen, my son is not born saved just because daddy's a preacher, any more than I was born saved just because my daddy's a preacher. You're not born saved. You were without Christ. Number two, you were aliens from the Commonwealth of Israel, meaning you had no rights of citizenship. It is a privilege to be a citizen of this country and all the rights and privileges that they're trying to take away from us, that the Constitution, the real authority of this country, guarantees us, regardless of what any elected official thinks they're the boss. The Constitution is the authority that we are under in this country. But listen, it is far, far, far greater to be a citizen of the kingdom of God than to be a citizen even of this great country. We were aliens from the Commonwealth of Israel. We didn't have any of the rights and privileges of God's people before we got saved. Number three, we were strangers from the covenants of promise. Do you realize that you could not claim, and if you're not saved, you cannot claim any of these promises of God that we've been singing about today? You can't claim those until you place your faith in Jesus, because you're a stranger from the covenant of promise. You don't have those blessings until you're saved. And remember, friend, without Jesus, we were without hope. You know what you have before you have faith in Jesus? You have no hope. No hope. You can have hope. We had no hope. Now we have it. That's why we sing. That's why we praise. That's why we worship. That's why we gather here, because of the hope that Jesus has given us. But before Jesus, you need to remember, you had no hope before Jesus. He didn't place you in Jesus and then you fell out. If these people were chosen for salvation before the foundation of the world, in what universe could Paul tell them that they once had no hope? Is Paul contradicting himself? May it never be. But without Jesus as Savior, there is no hope. Because as Acts says, there's no other name under heaven whereby men must be saved. Paul stood on Mars Hill in Athens in its glory days with all of the beautiful architecture of those wicked pagan temples, and he stood on that hill with all of those philosophers of his day, and he said, God has set a man, and he's going to judge you. He's going to judge the whole world, and he proved that he's the man by raising him from the dead. And now you need to repent, because apart from Jesus, you have no hope. But with Jesus, we have hope. And so remember what you didn't have, and then remember what you now have. In Christ, you've been brought near to all these things. Now you have Christ. Now you have citizenship in heaven. You know where I'm going to live? Forever? In the New Jerusalem. With my Lord and Savior. And I'll be able to visit this world. I'll be able to visit the whole place. But my citizenship is going to be the New Jerusalem with Jesus Christ. And if you're saved, that's going to be your home too. I get to be a citizen of heaven on earth for all eternity. Number three, I get the covenants of promise. Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 1 that all the promises of God are yes in Jesus. So all those promises that we've been singing about today, I get them in Jesus now because of the blood of Jesus. Because of what Jesus has paid for, I get hope. I get God. I get to call him my God, not just as my creator, but as my personal God who takes care of me because he's my heavenly Father. Remember the privileges that you have. Paul says, now in Christ Jesus, you used to be far off from all these things, but now by the blood of Christ you have been made nigh. Number three, not only do you have new purpose and new privileges, you have new peace. You have new peace. What keeps us up at night? Lack of peace. As I said in Sunday school, sometimes it's eating the wrong thing for dinner. That's what keeps you up. But most of the time, it's lack of peace. He is our peace. Look at verse 13. Now in Christ Jesus, we've been brought blood near by the blood of Christ. For verse 14, he is our peace, who hath made both one, hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances. He's talking about the law of Moses here. He's saying Jesus Christ fulfilled the law of Moses. And so the law of Moses does not have power anymore. And because the law of Moses doesn't have power anymore, you don't need to travel to Jerusalem to worship God. You didn't need to go to the temple in Jerusalem, which Jesus removed. God removed it because Jesus fulfilled all the requirements of the law. So there is no temple there because God doesn't need a temple. Because guess what? You are now the temple. We'll talk about that next week. But he is our peace. We have peace with God. Everybody wants to talk about equity. Equity, equity, equity. You know what true equity is? True equity is I can have peace with God through what Jesus Christ did, regardless of who my daddy is, regardless of how much melanin I have in my skin, regardless of what part of the world I was born in, regardless of how much money I have in my bank account. The ground at the foot of the cross is completely equal. We have, because guess what? Jesus paid it. Jesus paid the price. He paid the sin debt of all mankind. And now every one of us can become a child of God. And God doesn't have favorite kids. We have a favorite kid because we got one, right? One on earth, four in heaven. Four little miscarriage babies that are in heaven we'll get to meet someday. We have one. God treats us all the same. He loves us all. He couldn't love you anymore. He doesn't love you more than he loves me. He doesn't love me more than he loves you. That's equity. Only God can have true equity. We have peace with God. And number two, we have peace with each other. Now, we don't live it. We don't experience it, but that's your choice. That's on you. God has made us all equal, and so we can not only have peace with him, we have peace with each other. That's true equality. That's equality. God has provided that. Jew, Gentile, we have equality with God. He did it by sacrificing his body to fulfill the law. And so all who put their faith in him, there's neither Jew nor Greek, male nor female, slave nor free. All of us are one in Christ Jesus. We're all part of the family of God, all sons and daughters, brothers and sisters. We have peace, and that gives us number four, a new passage, verse 18. Verse 17, he came and preached peace to you which were far off, to them that were nigh. For through him we both, Jew and Gentile, all who are in Christ, have access by one Spirit unto the Father. We're going to talk about prayer tonight. I would invite you to come back to our evening service. We've been in the Old Testament a lot over the last several months on Sunday nights. We're going to be in the Old Testament a lot starting next month as we dive into the book of Daniel. But you know, one of the key themes in the book of Daniel, one of the things that made Daniel the man of God that he is, was prayer. So before we dive into Daniel, we're going to spend a few weeks and talk about prayer on Sunday nights. Here's what he says about prayer. We get to pray to God as our Father. And that's through the work that Jesus Christ has done. And even though we don't know how to talk to God correctly, the Holy Spirit prays with us. He prays for us. Romans 8 talks about that. So you pray. You talk to your daddy, your heavenly Father, your papa. You talk to him. The Holy Spirit will help you communicate. He's the Spirit of adoption. You have access into the very throne room of God so that you can come boldly to the throne of grace. to find mercy and grace in time of need. Some of you may not just need to come to the altar in a few minutes and just lay it on the altar. You can go, though, whether you're here or whether you're where you're standing, if you're in Jesus Christ, you can go to the throne of God at any moment to find the mercy and grace that you need. And you know why? Because lastly, number five, you have a new pedigree. You have a new pedigree. I don't care where you went to school. I don't care how much money's in your bank account. I don't care whether your name is on billboards and businesses. When I was a carpet cleaner in Altoona, I cleaned a lot of very nice homes. I've been in some of the nicest homes in Blair County. People whose last names you would recognize. And you know what I found? Their stuff gets dirty just like mine. Their dog pees on the carpet just like, you know, mine used to when I was a kid, had a dog. You know what else I found out? Because my boss is a talker, and he would talk to everybody. And I would, and so they talk about stuff because they were friends, and I'm standing right there, and they don't know me, but I got just like part of the wall, right? I found out they had some real issues, real family problems, just like everybody else. And all that money doesn't keep you healthy, and all that money doesn't keep your family functioning the way it should. And listen, all that pedigree means nothing in a few decades. But are you part of the family of God? Look at this as we close here. We'll pick it up here next week, but I want you to close. I want to close with this, verse 19. Now, therefore, ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints. Who's your favorite Bible character other than Jesus? I know Jesus is the answer, right? Who's your favorite Bible character? Noah? Well, we're all related to Noah. He's our daddy, just like Adam is, right? Daniel, Paul, brothers don't shake hands. Brothers got a hug. That's what Chris Farley said. I'm older than I look. You realize that for all eternity, we're going to begin to know our family? Oh, I want to see my family in heaven. I do. But when we get there, it's all family. We're all family. We're all brothers. We're all sisters. And that celebrity, that Christian celebrity that, oh man, wouldn't it be cool? Well, in heaven, we're just all going to be brothers and sisters. It ain't going to be no thing. We are fellow citizens. All of Abraham, brother. Father Abraham in heaven, he's my brother. And of the household of God. God's our Father. This is what resurrection realities God has given us. In Christ as the church, we have new purpose. We have new privileges. We have new peace. We have new passage. And we have new pedigree. Let's give him praise and worship as we close in prayer. Father, we thank you, God, for the incredible blessings you've given us, not only as individuals, but as a body. Help us to see each other the way you see us as individuals. Fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. Father, it's all because of Jesus. And Father, as we end this service right now, God, we extend this invitation. If there's somebody here who is not yet part of the household of God, they've never trusted in Jesus, God, I pray this would be the day they would come make that decision public. If they're not sure, if they don't understand, our deacons' wives will be here. Pastor Nick will be here. God, we want this to be the day that they trust in you for their salvation. God, whatever the decision, God, may your spirit be moving in each of our hearts. We ask this all in Jesus' name, amen. Will you stand as we close in a hymn? Again, the altar is open. If you need the altar, if you need to talk to Jesus where you are, let's worship him with this song as we close. Come every soul, my sin oppressed, there's mercy. This, but if you have a need, there's one more opportunity. Yes, Jesus is the truth, the way that leads you into rest. Believe in Him without delay, and you are fully blessed. Only trust Him. Thank you so much for your mercy and for your grace that was poured out onto us by sending your only begotten Son to die for our sins. Father, we praise you for raising him from the dead, victorious over sin, death, and the grave. Father, we thank you that it's only by your grace. It's only received through faith. It's not anything that we have to do. And so, God, that we praise you for that. God, thank you for the church. Thank you, God, for the privilege of being part of the body of Christ. Father, thank you for this church and for the witness it has been. And God, we pray as we commit ourselves to you, the witness it will continue to be. And God, we pray that you would help us to remember that we are brothers and sisters in you. And that, yes, we have squabbles, but God, we need to have love, love of family for one another, love of family for you. We thank you that by your Spirit, all of that is possible. We give you the praise and honor and glory, and we do it all in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Hope, Lord willing, we'll see you tonight at 6:30. You are dismissed. God bless.